Welcome, welcome. We're so glad that you can join us. A special word of welcome to our visitors. If you're visiting with us for the first time, we encourage you to fill out the little white card there in the pew pocket in front of you. Drop it in the offering plate so we can keep you up to date with what's happening here at First Pres. And also, if you have any prayer requests, we can be lifting those up. We do have a lot going on. Youth group is changing a little bit, and so the bulletin, I need to make a correction. There is high school after-school youth group tomorrow, Monday, from after school about 2:30 until 6. And then we have a new middle school group that Karina and I are co-leading. So that's for 6th, 7th, and 8th graders, and that starts this Wednesday at 4. It runs from 4 to 6 every Wednesday for 6th, 7th, and 8th graders. We can't wait to have you guys. Looking forward to that. So the new during the week schedule is high schoolers after school on Monday and middle schoolers 4 to 6 on Wednesday. We still have high school youth group Sunday after church until 4 as well. Stephanie has a big announcement about what's coming up this week about the Go Center.
So just in case you haven't heard, we are doing a church revitalization workshop Friday night, all day Saturday, and then Sunday morning. And so it's finally here. So we've all done that two-week Bible study together. And the church leaders are going to be meeting on Friday night to discuss that and to talk about some ways that we can start to grow this congregation and but really just reach more people for Christ. Your part is to come on Saturday, and in your bulletins, because I told you that I would have it for this week, is your I'm coming and I want to eat lunch form. So if you could fill that out. Just take a minute, fill it out, and then just stick it in the pews, like by the hymnals. And at the end of service, I will go around and I will grab them all. So that way you don't have to do anything but fill it out and then stick it in the pew. If you have any questions, let me know. But it's here and we're all excited. But not Sunday school.
Well, hi, Sunday school has started. We had our open house today to orient everybody from ages kindergarten up through middle school. And starting next week, there will be instruction. We're gonna work on the story of creation. And for the next 4 weeks, we're gonna be trying a new program. That is that the littlest kids are gonna have a room full of things to explore, to really get their fingers into creation. And then the older, slightly older kids from third to fifth are going to have, it's not completely accurate to say it's an escape room, but they are going to have three things to actually unlock each week. They're going to have puzzles to solve and things to think about so that they find the scripture somewhere on a map or somewhere in the Bible, so that they explore the ideas and the context, and so that they apply the ideas that we're studying to their own lives. And so those are the three things that are going to get reinforced every week. And then the middle schoolers, since they are older and in a whole new realm now, they're going to do something to keep their hands busy, and then they're going to have kind of an adult conversation around the questions that get raised during the story of creation, the story that comes from the Bible each week. Highly recommend that you send people that you love. And if you think that you might like to volunteer, we're looking for substitute teachers for when somebody gets sick. We're looking for people who would like to help put together supplies. And we're looking for, especially in the preschool room, we're looking for for the kindergarten, first, second room, not preschool at all. We're looking for extra sets of hands, because the more adults that are in there to give one-on-one time, the better, the richer the experience is. So come talk to me if you're interested in any of that or if you want more details.
Well, the session met this last Tuesday, and so here is my report to you. I'll try and be as brief as possible. As Pastor Peter was out of town, Jim Williams was our moderator, temporary moderator. We began the meeting with prayers for First Pres. We usually spend about 15 minutes or so going around in the circle, getting requests for prayer, both personal and for people within the church, within our community. So we spent right at the first part of our meeting, we spend time praying for one another with a devotion. So then we got into the meeting and we approved vital statistics for the last month, and we had two recent meetings, so we reviewed those minutes. We received a letter from the Siravag family, and they're requesting that their membership be released to a different church here in town. And reluctantly, the session acted on that. A written finance report was received. Session began discussing different ways to develop strategies to find new leaders within FPC, to bring up some new elders and deacons and nominating committee members. We're going to start working on that seriously here this month and next month. Hopefully the Go Center training will help with that. There were five building use requests that were reviewed. Four were approved and one was declined. Elders, we talked about elders, will be meeting with some folks who are interested in joining the church. We'll be doing that right after service today. It was passed to extend Peter's contract till the end of October. And it was also approved, voted on to approve a vacation day for him in middle September, September 18th. It was passed, moved second and passed to amend the 2022 budget by increasing the EPC meeting expenses by $3,000 with funds to be transferred from the general fund. Session has tried to be very intentional about being good stewards of our finances. We have, on one hand, we've been blessed with having elders who are interested in going down to Presbytery and the General Assembly, which in the years past, it was sort of, there were fewer people interested in actually going down and attending these meetings, but recently we've had more elders step up to do that, and that has been appreciated, and so with that has come the increased cost. Session has also, we've been using our mileage plan. So this last meeting, or I'm sorry, the next meeting in October, or end of September, beginning of October, we're traveling on miles and companion fare. So we're being intentional about keeping costs for travel to Presbytery and General Assembly low. Session was reminded that the first draft of the 2023 budget will be put together in October, so all ministry teams, and you know, whether you're involved in a ministry team as a committee member or as the chair of a committee, we're looking to get those budgets submitted as soon as possible within the month of September to the chair on finance. And then the final thing before we adjourned with prayer, there was a need to moved the session meeting in September from the third Tuesday to the second Tuesday. So the next session meeting will be on September 13th in the library. And that's all I have.
Thank you, Dave. All right, are we ready to worship? Please stand for the call to worship with George.
We gather together in the name of the living Christ to worship God.
Surely God is in this place and calls us to worship in truth and in truth.
God's love is for you and for all people everywhere.
That we may share God's love and life, may we be renewed in the refreshing spirit.
Living Christ.
The living Christ is with us.
Praise the Lord.
Please sing with me, shout to the joy and majesty.
My Jesus,
my Savior,
Lord, there is none like you. All of my days I want.
Refuge and strength.
Let us pray together and confess our sin. Lord and Creator of the universe, our Heavenly Father, we are amazed that you desired a personal relationship with each of us. We give you praise for making this possible through your Son, Jesus. Even more amazing, though, is the fact that so often we did not ourselves the opportunity of walking with you daily, receiving your love, wisdom, and power. Forgive us, Father, for wandering away from you, trying to live life in our strength. Forgive us for complaining when our own choices have led us down paths we do not wish to travel. Teach us instead to stay close fellowship with you, that every choice we make will reflect your presence in our lives.
Fill us each day with the love, joy, peace that are products of walking in obedience with you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Let us take a silent moment to confess our personal sins. Good news. God has done great things for us. We are loved, we are forgiven, and we are claimed by God's grace. The Holy One has begun a work in us. Even now, God's love is expanding our knowledge, sharpening our discernment, and equipping us for excellence. Go and bear fruit. Please sing with me, O Worship the King, number 24. The time in our service where we greet each other with the love of Christ, saying, "May the peace of Christ be with you."
And also with you.
Thank you.
Let's continue to worship by presenting our tithes and offerings. Lord God, we praise you, Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. You are the giver of life, the giver of love, the giver of grace. It is only by your grace that we might know your love, that we might secure your love in the name and the blood of Jesus Christ. And so God, even as we hold fast to your grace and your love, may we find it to be so abundant that we go out and share, that we go out and share the good news with what we say, with what we do, with how we live our lives. May these offerings be signs of our willingness to follow you wherever your kingdom dictates. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. You may be seated.
Well, good morning, everyone. It's an opportunity for us to share our joys and concerns. And one concern I have, this morning we were supposed to meet with Savannah, August, and Alaska for them becoming new members of the church, but they have COVID. And I fully know this, but Alaska is only like about 6 months old. So let's lift up all three of them. And anybody else do you know that has COVID, we're going to lift them up also. Father, we thank you so much for the gift of church and family that we can come together and hear these requests, knowing that you have put us in a position to pray for your people. So we lift up August, we lift up Savannah, little Alaska. And Father, we know that they are in your hands. And so we pray for the right resources. We pray for immediate healing. We pray for all those that we know, that God, we can continue to pray for them as they are an important part of our family. And Father, we pray that you would just bless them with healing. In your son's name, amen. Any other joys or concerns? Yes, Stephanie. Said that a little too loud.
Oh, I was just going to give an update from last week. My mom has left. She's in California at rehab. So thank you for your prayers for that.
Father, again, we thank you so much for the gift of mercy, for the gift of reconciliation. And Father, we know that we live in a world that trips us up. So Father, we pray for Kathy, that she knows that she's dearly loved from you, by you, and that you're giving her the strength that she needs to move on, to grow stronger, and to beat this thing in her life. So we pray for your blessings, we pray for strength, and we pray for Kathy to truly know that you are there, guiding her and loving her through all of this. In your son's name, amen.
Yeah. I praise the Lord for being in my heart. I'm having a tough time. I'm back on the streets again. I won't live at this shelter. I'm looking for an apartment. But it's getting rough. I'm just having a bad time. My leg is bothering me and everything. But just pray for me that I find that apartment.
Father, again, we pray for George, who is struggling right now trying to find a place. But Father, you know his situation. In fact, we have seen George throughout the year, and you provided him with all the resources that he needs. So, Father, I pray that you'll continue to bless him, continue to grow his mind, his heart, to know you and his will and his life. And we pray for finding that right place where he can live. And we ask this in your son's name. Amen. Any other? Yes, Lynn. I have a joy. I just want you to know that I got back from a wonderful trip in Pennsylvania. I got to meet my family. It's good food, good games, good opportunities to fellowship. And at the same time, Cynthia put me to work. And my hands will tell you, working on a roof and trying to replace it. But it was great. It's done. And I'm thankful for that. But yes, Lynn.
Well, we had been missing for several weeks because we were sick and we went camping. But a little old news, I wanted to thank everyone for your support and your excitement with me that the quilt that I made that took me 21 years to make by hand won Best in Show at the fair. That was so exciting for me. But my sister Amanda and her daughter Eden flew in last night after midnight, and they have not been here in 3 years. And so I am overjoyed that they're here. They're the first to come up, aside from my parents right at Isaiah's birth, to see the new baby. So please pray for 2 weeks of a very good visit and for everyone to stay healthy. And I'm just so grateful that they're here safely.
So your sister's name is?
Amanda.
Hey, Amanda and Edith. Good to see you here. So, oh, Eden has a garden. I forgot we're going to talk about that today. Well, let's thank God. Father, we do. We thank you so much for, again, for providing the resources that we need to get healthy. It's all about you. It's all about the ways you bring your goodness in our lives. And we thank you for the healing that's taking place in Lynn's family, as well as the gift that we can use to glorify you, knowing that everything that we have, every gift we have, everything that we make comes from you. And all we want to do is reflect your goodness and your love in our lives. And we thank you for that opportunity for Lynn. And we also thank you for her sister and her niece to be here and to be a part of her family and to enjoy Joy Fairbanks. Again, bless their time. We pray this in your son's name. Amen. Any other joys and concerns? Yes, over here. There we go.
Oh, I'd like to ask for prayers for the cyst that was found on my liver 2 months ago. And a week ago, my whole body started itching from neck down, and the doctor said it was due to the cyst on my liver. And just today, I ended up in the emergency room to where my liver was real painful, to where I had to go to the, he took me to the emergency room yesterday. That's how painful it was, and they had to give me morphine. And it's, my liver is, it's like the cyst is growing or something, and it's getting worse.
How do you feel this morning?
I feel okay.
Well, how about if I get the some of the elders out here and we could just pray for you, if you don't mind? So I, yeah. And your first name again is?
Corina.
Corina, that's right. And we do, in Scripture, it says that the elders come together and we lay hands on those that ask for prayers. And we're going to pray for Corina. And does anyone would like to lead and I can close? Anyone like to pray?
Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for being present here and working through all of our lives. We pray especially for Corina, and you know better what she needs. Just work through her, be with her, comfort her through this journey, and just be with the doctors and everyone that is helping her to figure this out. But we just pray for relief and peace through this journey.
Father, we thank you again for the ways that you bring us together. We are part of a family, and you do provide us with opportunities to share those burdens. And we pray for Karina as she shares this burden with us. We pray for healing. We pray for speedy recovery. And we thank you so much for the love that you pour out constantly in her life as well as ours. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Oh, yeah, we got Michelle.
Well, I have a joy to share. In the morning after I read my Bible, I go and sit out on the patio. And this was last week, and I was like, you know, I don't see any robins anymore, and the birds are not hanging out in my backyard like they usually do. So I sat there and I just was wondering, are they gone for the season and stuff? So I just kind of said, God, if they're still around, can you send them my way? And a couple days later, I was sitting out there, and there they were in my backyard, and all the birds and stuff. So it's kind of like, you know, just even the little things like wanting the robins to come back. And now what I want to pray for is the woodpeckers. I have actually seen a woodpecker in the yard behind us, but mostly we just hear them down the road on the telephone poles and stuff. So pray for my woodpeckers.
Okay. Okay, there's woodpeckers in Alaska. I didn't know that. Okay. So we're praying. We do. God provides us with opportunities just to be in his nature. And again, it's all God's plan to experience his goodness, his presence. And I also got a chance to see your anniversary picture. And, well, how did you end up choosing Lonnie as your husband? I mean, you're beautiful. I was. Well, let's pray. Father, we thank you for the many ways that you encountered us in our lives, especially with nature. You truly want us to look upon the stars, the planets, your creation, to see your handiwork, to see that you are continuing to creating and knitting things together. And those are ways of showing you to us. And we thank you for those opportunities with Michelle. And we thank you for the gift of woodpeckers and the many ways that we recognize certain animals that do spring something in our hearts and our lives. And Father, we thank you for this time you have invited us here. not because we chose to be here, but you chose us to be here, to become a part of your presence, to receive your word, to receive the goodness that comes from listening to you and experiencing your goodness in so many different ways. And Father, we know that we do have opportunities. We do have problems of having what we call is distracted minds. We allow ourselves to get caught up in little things that takes us away from your presence. So Father, help us. Help us to focus. And one of the ways that you help us to focus is to focus on the prayer that your Son has taught us. We pray together this prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Praise God. Well, it's children's time. I know that the children got into school this week. And for some of them, they are going, yeah, we're back in school. Some of them are going, oh, no, not again. School. I got to go through that stuff again. Well, school is awesome because you get to learn again, and you get to make new friends. Some of you are going, I'm coming into class. I have no idea who these people around is, but you need to know that some of you I've never met before until I got here, and because of that, I got to know you. So this is God's way of making new friends in our life. But I wanted to share with you an experience that I had when I went to Germany about 4 years ago. Do you know what a cathedral is? A cathedral is like the biggest church you can ever go. It's huge. It's so huge that you can look way up there. And actually, the cathedral I went into when I was in Munich, it was so huge that birds were flying back and forth up there. It was so large that it was bigger than a football field. Can you imagine a church bigger than a football? And when you walk in, you go in, and you go there, and you look up, and they have all these pictures, and they have stained glasses, and they have figurines. And over here, they show the picture of Jesus Christ when he was born with Mary and Joseph and the animals and how they got there, the angels. And it was just filled with colors and filled with pictures and filled with noises. And also when I was there, suddenly someone went up to this little thing called an organ, and he started to play. And there were pipes just filled the whole place, and the thing just went loud. It was crazy loud. And when it stopped, someone on the other side of the church, way down, started to talk. And what was crazy, I was able to hear him. But also what's new, what's special about this is a place of worship. People come there every day. They walk in, they see these symbols of the stories of Jesus on the cross and Mary and the apostles. They hear the songs, the organ. And the reason why this was made, and the reasons why people go to church and go there on a Sunday morning, because God invites them to go there to experience his presence. It was the biggest place I've ever been to. But what is so neat is that we have the same situation right here. God made this space very special. God made it in a way that when you walk in here, when you look at the cross, when you look at God's word, when you see the lights, when you see all these things and the people, it reminds us that God is alive. And when we sing those songs, when we pray those prayers, God is speaking to us. God is trying to get our attention, and God wants to know that he is alive, he is living, and that this happens not just now, but all day. God wants us to recognize that we can recognize his presence every time. Like when Michelle said that when she went outside and saw all those animals, that is a way that God reminds us that he's real and he's there. So worship is a very important part of what we do as children, as people a part of the church. So I pray that we would go ahead and recognize the importance of coming to worship. So let's bow our heads and let's pray. Let's say this. Say, dear God, thank you so much for inviting me to be here this morning to experience your living presence. Help me to know. Help me to listen. And help me to grow. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. God bless you. Get to go back to your family, to your friends, and let's go ahead and rise as we continue by reading God's Word. God's Word is alive. It speaks to us. This morning, God has presented these words to us so that we can hear His Word for us this morning.
But worship was never meant to be a place to go to. That God never intended us for us to come to these buildings, to synagogues, to tabernacles. That was not God's plan. God's plan was for us to be able to have a lifestyle of worship. It's an everyday occurrence with the presence of God. But we live in a sinful world, and what happens, God knows that we need things to remind us of His living presence. He provides these opportunities so that we can experience His goodness. And then He invites us, as a matter of fact, He asks us to come on a regular basis so that we can, because outside in the world, it removes us from having this acute sense that God is living in our lives. And we get so caught up in the world that we forget that God wants us to have a lifestyle of worship. Can you hear me?
Barely.
Barely, okay. So I have my mic on.
Sure.
Can you hear me now?
Yeah.
Okay, let me start again. Okay. I heard you heard some of it. But it's important, like I said earlier, worship, going to worship was not something that God intended us to be in. God intended us to be able to walk in the garden and to enjoy His presence on a moment-by-moment basis. Now, God did set up ways for us to experience His presence right now in this world, but one day we won't have to worry about that. So right now, what He tries to do, He tries to help us to capture that Eden experience, that Garden of Eden experience, because that's where we should have been living. And God has also given us a foretaste what heaven is going to feel and look like. But I think all of us here have had many different worship experiences, gone to different churches. And again, I want to make it very clear, there's a clear definition between church and worship. Church is the body of people. It's the family. We've taken it as a place to go to, but actually it is us. We are the church. We are the people. We are the family. Just going to wait. I want to make sure that... But worship is a whole different experience. Worship is about listening to God's invitation to come into His living presence. This is not a performance. This is an opportunity for us to receive God's word and to experience his living presence. He always wanted us to experience that with our senses, because that was the walk in the garden. That was how God intended us to live. Worship is a lifestyle. It's a lifestyle that God is teaching us and wanting us to participate, because that is where we're going to have our great sense of joy and purpose in his world. When we are worshiping God, when we're receiving his presence, when we're in his presence, we have this amazing sense of joy because we have a right relationship. God wants us to experience that joy every day. At the same time, we have an awesome understanding of our purpose, because we have this connection to God. We know our purpose is to glorify God, to live out our life in the world that God has given us. So I've had many, many experiences. I'm pretty sure some of us here can sit back and share with the many places you've been to and the many different worship experiences. I've had a chance to visit cathedrals. Has anybody ever been to a cathedral before? They're huge. My goodness, they're huge, and they're wonderful. And I went to two cathedrals in Munich and in Nuremberg. Then I went to a cathedral of all the places in St. Louis. There is a cathedral in St. Louis. Surprise the dickens out of me. But as you walk into that place, the cathedral is meant to give you a sense of phenomenal, an experience of senses. You know, you go there, the lighting, the images, the symbols. And again, remember back in the medieval times when they built these cathedrals, people were literate. So these symbols, these pictures, all these things was like a comic book to them. They look at it, and every day they walk into the worship service and into that temple, they're reminded of the story of God and his living presence. Everything about a cathedral was to make you come into it and have and walk away with this full experience of sensing God's presence with your feelings, your perceptions. I've been there now. Also, I've been in other places. I've been in a church where the floor was a dirt floor. You know, I went to a worship service in a YMCA for the longest times. In a house, outdoors in a beautiful valley, an opportunity. There was a church service in a valley, and you could see it was a sunrise service. You could see the sun coming up, and you could see the mountains. You could just hear all the noises that are out there, and we're able to experience God in a whole different way. Beaches, an all-stone church, Air Force Academy. I had a chance in Jerusalem to go to a church. You walk into it. It's an all-stone church. You walk in it, and people would sit way up in the front, and they would go into a little place here where the singers would be, and people would actually could talk, and you could hear them way down there, like they're speaking right next to you. And then they start singing. The acoustics was amazing. Beautiful places. The Air Force Academy, if you ever had a chance to go there, that building itself is a sight to see. The buildings. In times, church service is not just on a Sunday morning, but you have mid-morning, you have afternoon, you have sunrise services, you have evening, you have midnight. I don't know if you ever had a church where you went through all midnight. You have on Saturdays, midweek, an opportunity for people to come in together and worship God. Ethnic groups, many opportunities to worship with different cultures. I had a chance to worship many times the Mexican people, Korean people, German people, Belgium, Greek, Russian, Black, Jamaica. I was actually in a worship service where it was a deaf Jamaica community. And that's amazing to see deaf people worship with their hands and their faces. As we try to follow along, people that can hear and actually be able to use their voice. I had a chance to meet, been at lots of mainline churches. Presbyterian, Methodist, Lutheran, Anglican, Catholic, Episcopals, even Assemblies of God, Church of God, Baptist, non-denominational, Church of Christ, many, many church worship experiences. And in situations where the responses from the audience were amazing. Some were just loud. I mean, I had a chance to preach in a lot of these places, and it is such a beautiful feeling as a pastor, and you're preaching, and someone goes, "Preacher, brother. Preacher, brother, say it again." Yeah, and hallelujah, amen. And then we clapping hands, people raising their hands. You know, then, you know, I've been to churches where you can literally hear a pin drop. It's that quiet. Now, just a little side note from us Presbyterian pastors. We believe that Presbyterians also in some way share their exuberance when it comes to affirming the pastor. So some places, we love the amen. We love the hallelujah, but when we sit there and see you turn around to your neighbor and look and do like this, that was a good point. We knew we hit on something. So, at the same time, I've been to churches where it was hard rock, guitars blazing, drums blazing, and you're sitting there thinking, no way. I've been to places where there was no music. I've been to many different contemporary styles of music, many styles of liturgy, hymns playing, music all of all types, instruments of all types. But the most important part of all of this, those are authentic worship opportunities, and all of them have this single thread that runs through them. And that thread is they worship in spirit and in truth. That is the key when it comes to worship. It's that some people, because of their culture, like music and they like their preaching differently, but it's still based on spirit and truth, God's truth. Some people like the contemporary style, some people like the classical, some people like the loud rock, some people like it quiet. But the important thing, what is very important, we measure all these places, do they speak the truth, and are we spiritually connected to God through Jesus Christ? That is what it is, and that's what's important. This style of worship service is great, but it's not the style. There's no such thing as the style. There is a style that God gives us, and that is, are we worshiping God in spirit and truth? And the thing is that the worship experience is meant to teach us that we need to live a lifestyle of worship. Not just a Sunday morning, but when we get together every week, when we're struggling with the outside world, when it tries to confuse us and at the same time tries to lie to us, we come together and God gives us an experience what worship should be like and how we can carry this attitude, this lifestyle of worship into the real world. That is God's gift to us. God intended us to worship on a day-by-day basis. This is where we experience joy. This is where we experience purpose in our lives. That is God's gift to us. So why are there so many different styles of worship? Well, again, like I said earlier, just like restaurants. You know, there's so many restaurants out there, and we all have our favorite restaurant. But the important thing about a restaurant, does it serve food that sustains our life? Because of worship, because of cultures, there's many styles of worship. Again, the culture, because of who they are. But again, what's important is the food that's being fed to us. So here is a history of worship. As I shared earlier with you, that God never intended us to come to a place, to go to a building. God intended us to walk in a world in the Garden of Eden. In fact, I just learned a little girl's name, Eden. In the Garden of Eden, to be able to worship God with our senses. We miss. In fact, we are created to talk. We're created to see. We're created to feel. We're created all these things that God intended us to worship this way, to experience Him this way. See, there was no need for faith. There was no need for hope. That was never a part of the worship experience what in the garden. Because we didn't have to have hope because hope was secure. We knew that we were going to live forever. There was no need for hope for the future. Right now, we need hope. We need to know that we have a future, that God has destined us to be a part of His eternal plan. Also, faith. Faith is something that we need because in the midst of all the things that hit our senses, sometimes we have doubts. In fact, the sinful nature is about doubting. And what God wants us to do in the midst of those doubts is to trust His Word, and we need the faith to be able to trust His Word and be able to take the actions that we need to take when it comes to living our life. That was never meant to be in the Garden of Eden. What we experienced in the Garden of Eden was God's love at every second of our lives. And the neat thing is that God knows in when the sin came into the world, it completely shattered that. We know the story. God says, no longer you can be in the Garden of Eden. No longer your relationship with me is going to be the same. I've taken away the fruit of the eternal life. It's different. But God loves us so dearly. This is His mercy and grace. I'm going to provide a way for you so that you can experience my presence. Okay? And I'm going to give you an aftertaste of what Eden is like. Have you ever had a meal that was so good at lunchtime. Oh, ribs with the right sauce. Oh, gosh. With the right rub, with the right, you know I'm a rib nut. And, you know, and you ate it for lunch. And at supper, you're sitting there going, oh, I still can taste that. That aftertaste. And God says, I want you to experience the aftertaste of what took place in the Garden of Eden. So I'm going to set up ways in that you can experience that. Also, I'm going to give you a foretaste. And that foretaste, as Jesus said, is waiting when we get to heaven. There is a foretaste. There is the time where we can sit there and say, I can't wait for the second coming of Jesus Christ. I can't wait there to be with my friends and family. That foretaste helps us. But in the meantime, God provides us with a way to experience His presence right now. That is the history of worship. So one of the first things He does, He puts together the tabernacle. God knew that we need something. Something that allows us to see, hear, and smell. Something that allows us to know that God is real. And He provided the tabernacle for the people when they were in the desert. If you look at the tabernacle, all the elements in the tabernacle was a way for us to experience, again, worship, the living presence of God, so that when we enter that place, so we could be able to see in all those things that are sensed or feel, that we sit back and know that God has, again, invited us into His presence, that we know that God is real. That was the tabernacle. That's what God did for us. That was His way of saying, I'm going to give you an opportunity to experience me again with my senses. So what we have in the tabernacle, just a couple things. We have, just again, this is God's way, we have the Ark of the Covenant. In the garden, the tree of life was in the middle. That was a sign. That was a way, as we are walking, we know that God is there, God has given us life, and that is a way for us to know that we are in His loving presence. So God provides us with the Ark of the Covenant. Again, the Ark was a reminder of God's living presence. It was there. You could see it. There were things and elements in it. It also was a 6-branch, 7-lamp. Menorah, you could see the light. The light, the eternal light. The light that tells us that God is alive. And the table for showbread. Again, the opportunity for us to taste. And the altar of incense. An opportunity for us to smell. So when we walk into this very reverent place, when we see all these symbols, we go in there and we notice that we're in a place where God has put together, has invited us to be there to experience His presence. And He continued that with the temple, and He continues to do that today. The reason why we have worship service, okay, why we have a place, why we continue to have all these symbols, is a way for us to God, again, to have the aftertaste of the worship that was taking place in the Garden of Eden. Sometimes why we meet in buildings, why we do that on a regular basis, because this is God's plan. God truly wants us to experience His living presence. The sad thing is that people come in and we take worship for granted. We come in here and think, well, it's some type of performance. You know, it's a performance for me. I want to make sure that the hymns are right. I want to make sure the preaching is right. I want to make sure the word's right. You know, everything is about me. The worship is not about me. The worship is about me entering into God's presence and for me to receive His word. It's not about the timing of the service. It's not about the correctness of the words in that. Now, definitely, it has to be based on truth. Jesus said it very clearly, my truth. I am the truth. And we're going to look at this. So we have this neat story. It's one of my favorite stories. The Samaritan woman. I love that story. There's so much goodness. There's so many great things to learn from the Samaritan story. It is one of the most profound stories in the New Testament. So here it is. Jesus Christ is moving. He's traveling. And He decides He's going to go to Galilee. And He takes the disciples and said, I'm going to go through Samaritan, which was not the route that you go through. You never go through Samaritan because that's not a place to go through because they did not have the same culture standards, especially with their religious practices, as the Jewish people. So you get around them. They're unclean. So He said, no way. I'm Jesus Christ. I'm Lord. I'm the King of Kings. I am God, and I can do what I believe is necessary. So He goes through the Samaritan, and He does something that's crazy, beautiful, and wonderful. And that is, He goes at the midtime, and here it is, a Samaritan woman who is an adulteress and a divorcee and a Samaritan. And she is shunned because she has to go in the middle of the day because the people, the women of the community would not allow her to come in the morning. So she's there grabbing water. And Jesus comes by and says, hey, would you please give me a cup of water? I'm thirsty. Great story. I love this story. And you go, well, if you know any better, you wouldn't ask for me. Do you understand my situation? You're a Jewish person. You know about this. And Jesus said, wait, hey, I got something that's better than what you are thinking that you need right now. I'm the living word. I'm the living waters, and I give you water that you'll never, ever thirst. And Jesus goes with this dialogue with the Samaritan woman. That is so amazing. That's beautiful. He recognizes her need, her intimate, most important need in her life. And that need was him, Jesus Christ, the Messiah, the one who can give her mercy and grace and salvation. And so they go through this dialogue, and he started to say things, and one thing he immediately brought up, just a new, you know, never met her before. Hey, you have five husbands, and the one you're living with is not yours. I mean, wow, I've never met this person before. He's able to see inside my life. He speaks to the sin that I'm struggling with, and she tries to sit there. Well, you're a prophet, and tries to skirt it, don't we? When it comes to us confronting our sin, a lot of times what we do is we can skirt it easily. But Jesus is amazing here, and let's hear the story. The woman said to him, sir, I perceive that you are a prophet. Prophet meaning you are a person who can understand, and especially in this situation, you know who I am. Our fathers worship, here again, she's putting a little push to the side here, trying to get him away from that on the mountain. But you say that in Jerusalem is the place where people ought to worship. So you have two different cultural wars here. You know, worship wars. One on the mountain, one in Jerusalem. Got it right there. Again, Jesus said to her, woman, believe me, the hour is coming when neither on this mountain nor in Jerusalem will you worship the Father. He's very, very, very clear. You worship what you do not know. We worship what we know, for salvation is from the Jews. He's making it very, very clear that your understanding of salvation is wrong. The Jewish understanding of salvation is right, and that salvation is wrapped up in a package called the Messiah, and that Messiah is going to liberate you from the sins that you have. But the hour is coming and is now here when the true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and truth. He made it very, very clear how we are going to worship. He didn't say we're going to worship with electric guitars. He didn't say we're going to worship in the cathedral. He didn't say we're going to worship on a beach. He didn't, you know, he said it very clear. We are to worship in spirit and truth. Now, Jesus Christ in the book of John makes it very clear on one thing. The only way a person can see and experience the kingdom of God is one thing. And he said in John 3 that you need to be born again. And here it says in 3:3, he says, truly, truly, and again, anytime Jesus says truly, truly in Scripture, he's not messing around. He's flatly telling, I am telling the truth, and you can't negotiate. This is truth. This is the absolute. You can't get around. I am the truth. I'm telling the truth. Truthfully, truthfully, he is saying, unless you're born again, you cannot see the kingdom of God. God says that you have to be birthed into the kingdom. You have to be spiritually alive. Because when you're spiritually alive, you're able to see the kingdom of God. You know who your Father is, and you know the work and the reason why I came into the world. For this Father is seeking such people to worship him. God is spirit, and those who worship him must worship in spirit and truth. God always, 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 always intended us to worship him. That is our lot in life. That is a blessing in life. We're thinking, wow, worship? Come on. No, we were designed and created to worship God. Okay? Worship means, here's a good understanding of it, is the dramatic celebration of God in his supreme worth in such a manner that his worthiness becomes the norm and inspiration of a human living. Okay. It basically says, I recognize the living presence of God. I recognize his worthiness, and I respond to that worthiness. I give credence to that worthiness. I recognize that worthiness is vital to who I am as a person. And because of that, I'm willing to continue to worship this person on a regular basis. Worship was always meant to be a gift. It was always meant to be a part of who we are. It was always meant to be a gift and an attitude and a lifestyle that we're constantly recognizing God's presence. We experience His joy. We understand His purpose. It's something that happens constantly. Sin has destroyed that opportunity to truly experience that on a moment-by-moment basis. That's why we get together on a Sunday morning. That's why we continue to allow God's Spirit to remind us of the importance of having a lifestyle of worship. So, the woman said to him, I know the Messiah is coming, he who is called Christ. When he comes, he will tell us all things. Jesus said to her, I who speak to you am he. I am he. I am the one. I am the Messiah. I am the Christ. I am the anointed one. I am that person. I'm the person who could tell you how to worship your Father in heaven. So today, the application is this. Worship is a lifestyle. It's always is meant to be a lifestyle. Not something that happens on a Sunday morning. Not something that happens in a cathedral. Not something that happens on a dirty floor in a nice, in a hut in Mexico. Worship is meant to be a life that we live out every moment of our life. It is God's gift to us. Now, lifestyle. Now, you know that I've been living in Fairbanks for a year and a half. And you need to know that people that live in Fairbanks, the lower 48 people think that you're weird. I'm serious. Who would live in Fairbanks? Who would, one, experience 30 below -30 below weather, and kind of like it. Who likes the idea that you're dark most of the night in the wintertime? Who likes the idea that you can't go to sleep at night because the sun is shining brightly through your window? Yeah, they think of Fairbanks people very, very differently. We have, because I'm a part of it, a very unique culture. Okay? It's a very unique lifestyle. And trying to explain that to the person in the lower 48 can be very difficult. Have you ever had to do that? None of you? I'm the only guy? Jeez, you don't get out much? So I said, okay, here's one way. I said, first of all, Anchorage is not even Alaska. Don't even consider Anchorage to be Alaska. Right on. Yeah, it's a metropolis, right? It's a city in the middle of... You know, it's a beautiful place, but they're missing that place because it's all a big city. I said, Anchorage is like this. Anchorage is like going, when you get your coffee, you go to Starbucks. And Lord, for you guys, yeah, I know what that means. Yeah. But Fairbanks, you go to a parking lot, and you go to your trailer, and get your coffee. Even at 30 below, the coffee is still there. They go, whoa. So that's one way. I mean, so they're getting a feel for that culture. Also, you need to know that every vehicle in Fairbanks has an electrical cord that sticks out in the front. Everywhere you go, people that live in Fairbanks have this electrical cord there. They go, what? Yeah, it's an electrical cord. It looks like almost like a tail, but in the front. Yeah, they plug in their car every winter. They go, all right. So they're trying to get a picture of this culture. Also, I said, almost everybody in Fairbanks have eaten moose and caribou. That's another one. They go, what? So the key is we have a lifestyle. We know what that lifestyle is. In the same way, God is trying to provide us with a lifestyle, that worship is a lifestyle. Christians are to live in it. But we also know, as I heard earlier, that God literally gives us a place and a time to come here. Coming on Sunday morning should be a blessing. It's not should, I'm writing off my little duty list. You know, I'm a Presbyterian for 50 years, my duty is to come on Sunday morning. Well, that's awful. I come into the worship service because I'm invited. God says, you are here because invited to come here. I have chosen musicians. I've chosen George here to lead us in worship. I've chosen Pastor Peter to read the word. to pray. All those things are my gift to you. It's a way for you to experience. They are experienced. This is all about God. And right now it's 20 after and God says it doesn't matter. Because it's about his time. It's about his presence. It's about his goodness being revealed to us. That's why we go to worship service. It's not here to be entertained, but God, I'm in your presence. And I'm going to receive to you this morning. And how can I be very just to worship you? And we worship in spirit and truth. You cannot worship God if you're not in the kingdom of God. You can't. If you're not born again, if you're not spiritually alive with Jesus Christ, you walk into a situation and you're going, okay, I'm doing this because of my family. I'm doing it because something I've done because I've grown up. But if we don't understand that we are spiritually alive, it's very, very, very almost impossible. It is impossible to have an understanding that I'm connected to the living God that's here right now, that's with us. That's why Jesus Christ says you have to, in order to see the kingdom of God, you have to be spiritually alive. You have to be born again. Now, here's just a little way to understand that. Football season is now. It's great. It's awesome. Okay? And some of you are going, you're nuts, Pastor Peter. I hate football. I want nothing to do with it. I have no understanding of it. Why? I love football because I'm into it. I have a mentality of football. For people outside of that pocket, they think I'm a weird bird. And you think, hey, wasting your time there? No. Something has to happen to our focus. Something has to happen to our perception to truly understand this type of thinking. God says the only way that you truly understand worship is you have to be spiritually alive. And then, very clear, truth. We live in a world that's filled with lies. We live in a world that we have believed in some of those lies. Let me just throw one out there. Don't raise your hand. Do you believe when I die or when our people die that we're going to turn into angels and we're going to get wings? Some people believe that. There's Christians that believe that. Now, I'm taking an extreme example, but there is a lot of untruths that are out there. And Jesus Christ said, I am the truth. In the process of worshiping me, I'm going to help you to understand how to respond to me truthfully. You're going to learn what it means to respond to me truthfully, because that is for your benefit. So, I'm going to end with this, that, again, worshiping God is a lifestyle. It's a lifestyle. God provides us with a Sunday morning at First Presbyterian Church, and we have some members who are going to commit to this church here to be a part of God's plan for us. And there's other churches that do it differently, but that is God's plan for them. But it is a gift. And we're in a process of, David and I, we're going to do a sermon series about worship. We're going to do a sermon series how worship is also intricate, very important as a disciple of Christ. In fact, to be a disciple of Christ, you have to be a worshiper. If we don't understand that, then being a disciple of Christ is just about learning a rule book. But a disciple of Christ is a person who understands the living presence of worship every day. So I hope we have, all of us here, can see and feel and experience and taste and hear, see the experience of the blessing that comes from worshiping God this morning. Let's bow our heads and pray. Father, we do. We thank you so much for inviting us. It is all about you. Help us, God, just to truly allow your spirit to remind us of the moment-by-moment worship opportunities that we have every day. In Jesus' name, amen.
Please stand for our final song, Waymaker. Thank you.
Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, our God, that is who you are. You are here, touching every heart. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, healing every heart. Working, you never stop, you never stop working, never stop, you never stop working. That is who you are, that is who you are, that is who you are. That is who you are.
Can you hear amen?
Amen.
Amen. If there's a person or persons here that has never experienced the kingdom of God, and you're struggling with that concept, and you truly want to be a part of the kingdom of God, all you have to do is say, Jesus Christ, I want you as my Lord and Savior. Please come into my life. Please open my eyes to the kingdom of God. You go nowhere by accident. Wherever you go, God is sending you. Wherever you are, God has put you there. He has a purpose in you being there. Christ who indwells you has something he wants to do through you. Wherever you are, believe this and go in his grace and in his love and in his power. Amen.